President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. graces the Philippine Mayor's Forum in Manila. Let's get more details from our very own Pia Gutierrez. Pia.
Yes, Carmina, President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. on Friday urged the Philippine local government units to explore international partnerships to learn the best practices in improving public service delivery. This as he acknowledged that there are new and emerging challenges that should be addressed by both local and national governments. The president made this statement in a speech at the Philippine Mayor's Forum in Quezon City, attended by local government executives around the country. The event, hosted by the Department of Interior and Local Government and the United Nations, is aimed towards empowering LGUs as allies of the national government, while also emphasizing their critical contribution to the implementation of the United Nations Sustainable Development Goals, or SDGs. In his speech, the president welcomed the event as the most opportune time for the national government agencies and the LGUs to come together with the support of international partners to augment strategies and approaches towards achieving the Sustainable Development Goals. He also expressed hope that the discussions would result in the wider adoption of multi-level governance, the rise of smarter and more sustainable communities, and the emergence of stronger and more resilient local institutions. In his speech, the president also challenged Philippine Mayor to take advantage of the knowledge and experience that the United Nations has gained around the world to capacitate themselves and to make them more knowledgeable, particularly in solving the problems that they are now facing. He also assured that the national government will remain the LGU's leading partner in enhancing their capacity to achieve the administration's Sustainable Development Goals, or the Ambition Natin 2040.
We are now in the 21st century. There are new challenges in both the local and national levels, issues that were not conceived of by the code's framers 30 years ago, that require us now to discover, to explore, to employ better ways of capacitating our localities. So I welcome this forum, which seeks to harness the power of innovation, digital governance, resiliency building, to ensure that the government can better respond to the demands of the times. And when I speak of government, I speak of government at every level.
Carmina, the Mayor's Forum coincides with the 32nd anniversary of the enactment of the Local Government Code of 1991, which provided the country with guidelines on devolution, efficiency, and the self-sustainability of LGUs. The President noted that his administration is now finalizing the executive order for the final implementation of the Mandanas-Crispia ruling, which he says will further strengthen the autonomy of local government units in the country. Carmina.
Thanks a lot, Pia Gutierrez there, joining us on the line. Suspected vote-buying activity in Navotas under scrutiny by Philippine election officials. There is also mounting concern over incidents of election-related violence leading up to Monday's village and youth council polls. Victoria Tulad reports.
Commission on Elections Chairman George Garcia is convinced there is a candidate or influential person behind the alleged vote-buying incident in Navotas on Wednesday. The poll body vows to dig deeper into the incident.
Hindi pa pwedeng kasuhan lang namin yung mismong nandun sa mismong lamesa na namimigay ng envelope. Sino ang nasa likod nun? Siyempre may mga pinanggalingan po yung pera.
COMELEC has been alerted about the illegal activity since Sunday, which involves a woman who allegedly gave out envelopes containing 300 pesos to 200 participants. The woman claimed they were conducting a poll watchers training.
Wala namang trainer, walang watchers kit, wala namang kahit na anong mga ginagamit para i-train yung mga allegedly mga watchers daw pong iyan.
The poll body says the candidate who will be proven to be behind the alleged vote-buying incident will be disqualified from the village and youth council polls on October 30. This bet or any individual linked to the incident will also be slapped with an election offense, including those who accepted the money.
Whether you're an elective official or an appointed official, pag ang issue na po pamimili, sobrat doble po ang galit ng Commission on Elections dyan. Para na rin po yung galit namin kapag kami karahasan na against po sa isang kandidato na tumatakbo, isang incumbent na tumatakbo.
In the meantime, incidents of possible election-related violence continue to happen in the lead-up to the polls. In Sagayan Village, Kapatagan, Lanao del Sur, one aspirant for village chief died after being shot while fetching water. His wife and 7-year-old child were also wounded in the attack. In Kamantangan Village in Davao de Oro, authorities are investigating the killing of another bet for village chief. COMELEC is also monitoring the situation in Abra amid incidents of election-related violence.
The other day, nagdagdag pa sila ng 150 more na mga kapulisan sa Abra. As of now po, talagang hindi naman po namin nakita na yung Abra kailangan ilagay under COMELEC control.
In Negros Oriental, which is under COMELEC control, a curfew will be implemented from 10 p.m. to 4 a.m. on October 28 to October 30 as a security measure. In order to monitor all incidents and reports related to the elections, such as violence and complaints against candidates, COMELEC has opened its Command and Operations Center here in Intramuros, Manila. Proclamation of candidates will also be monitored in the command center. Victoria Tulad, ABS-CBN News.
Hundreds of police personnel tapped to be part of the Board of Election Inspectors in the Bangsamoro region. Over 280 villages in the region were put under red category amid rising incidents of election-related violence there. The Philippine Poll Body and the PNP assure the public of their safety as they cast their ballots in the Monday or in Monday's elections. Authorities in air and seaports in Cebu gearing up for the anticipated passenger influx this long holiday break. Let's get an update from our correspondent, Annie Perez. Annie, what's the situation there?
Yes, that's right, Carmina. The Aviation Authority of the Mactan Cebu International Airport announced that they are now on heightened alert as passenger influx is set to increase this weekend. General Manager Julius Neri made his rounds of inspection to the terminals of this airport. He says they want to make sure that despite the high volume of passengers, seniors or children or all passengers in general must experience a smooth manner in their travel to this airport. Help desks were installed in vital areas of the Mactan Cebu International Airport, and personnel assigned are tasked to assist any passenger or to respond to any incident. They're also ensuring enough personnel that will be available to man their luggage carousels and connecting hubs. Neri sees this as the common area of problem during increased number of passengers during long weekends or holidays. Meanwhile, the Cebu Port Authority also said that all ports are on heightened alert status, which shall last for 10 days. CPA General Manager Francisco Comendador III said that they already started coordination during the start of October, and they're expecting also a smooth flow of the barangay and SK elections and UNLAS 2023 as passengers come and go. He adds, they're expecting a passenger traffic to exceed 500,000, surpassing last year's average. CPA will also strictly impose the no boat ticket, no ID, no entry policy. K-9 units from both the Philippine Drug Enforcement Agency and Philippine Coast Guard will also be deployed. They're also on the lookout for any illegal boat ticket stopping individuals which may be held liable. So far, terminal operations are doing good despite the influx of passengers. Some trips are already fully booked, so they're asking the public to coordinate directly with the shipping companies. And that's the latest here from Cebu, Annie Perez, ABS-CBN News.
The Manila North Cemetery, where over 1 million people are expected to visit for the upcoming All Saints Day. Jeffrey Ernaez is there with the latest. Jeffrey.
Hi, Carmina. The leadership of the Manila North Cemetery has ensured that they are prepared for the expected influx of visitors this coming All Saints Day. According to Manila North Cemetery Director Rosel Castañeda, they anticipate that over 1 million people will visit the cemetery due to the easing of restrictions imposed during the COVID-19 pandemic. Castañeda also reminds people about the guidelines to be followed this year. These include the prohibition of bringing alcoholic beverages, flammable materials, playing cards, firearms, and knives. The use of sound systems inside the cemetery will also be strictly prohibited. The main gates of the cemetery will be open from 5 a.m. to 5 p.m. from October 30 to November 3. No visitors will be allowed to enter beyond 5 p.m., while those already inside the cemetery will need to vacate the premises before 7 p.m. Castañeda has also assured that there will be fire trucks, ambulances, and medical personnel in case of a medical emergency. Meanwhile, MMDA Assistant Secretary Angelo Vargas conducted an inspection at the cemetery earlier today. The agency will assign 196 traffic enforcers outside the cemetery and street sweepers for the daily garbage collection.
Let's now check the situation at the Manila South Cemetery ahead of All Saints Day. Jervis Manahan now joins us with the latest from there. Jervis.
Yes, Carmina, it's still pretty quiet inside the Manila South Cemetery. Vendors of candles and flowers have lined up the main alley. The period of cleaning the tombs have lapsed last Wednesday, so the public aren't allowed to bring cleaning materials here. The last day of burials is on Sunday, and it will be suspended to give way to an expected surge of visitors this All Saints Day. Normal operations will resume on the 3rd of November. Like many other cemeteries, there are prohibited objects like vidyoke, liquor, pointed objects, and flammable materials. A tent is being set up inside for the headquarters of cemetery officials.
Let's now get an outlook and make that an outlook on the weather today and the upcoming long holiday weekend. We have on the line Pag-asa weather forecaster Lori De La Cruz. Lori, go ahead.
Yes, good morning, ma'am, and all our viewers and listeners. At the moment, the northeast monsoon continues to prevail over northern and central Luzon, and it's causing partly cloudy to cloudy skies with isolated light rains over the whole northern Luzon and central Luzon. And here in Metro Manila and the rest of the country, we will be generally partly cloudy to cloudy with isolated rain showers or thunderstorms in the afternoon or evening. And this scenario, weather scenario, is likely to persist until tomorrow. And then by Sunday, it's also possible that Eastern Visayas, Bicol region, and Caraga will be cloudy with scattered rains and thunderstorms due to possible interaction of the shear line and the low and a possible occurrence of a low pressure area over the eastern portion of the country. Then the northern Luzon and central Luzon will be experiencing isolated light rays due to northeast monsoon. That's the latest from Pag-asa. This is Lori De La Cruz.
Thanks a lot, Lori.